Hare Krishna. My name is Jaya Rama. I am a disciple of His Holiness Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. And I'm sitting here in the official ISKCON temple of Zurich, Switzerland. Behind me is the Sri Surabhi campaign banner, which has been just started by His Holiness Bhaktivedanta Swami 2 days ago with a Go Puja in Lamental, and has been continued yesterday by another Go Puja on the first Ahimsa farm in Switzerland, the Vaikuntha farm. So I'm asking eagerly for Bhaktivedanta Swami to ask some questions, and I hope to be able to reply properly.
One of the important aspects in terms of present day society, how relevant and how important is Varnasram when we look at the modern day situation, global situation around the world? How can Varnasram address many of the problems? What are some of the problems actually that in your experience are major and that can be possibly addressed in different ways?
Mm-hmm. Maybe before I answer, come to the answer of the question, let me give a little bit from what background I have learned about these issues. So I studied economics, and at a very prestigious school in Switzerland, it would be called the MIT of the German world, the University of St. Gallen. It had at the time already a line of education, how to deal with limited natural resources, by Professor Dr. Binswanger. And I was actually very attracted at that time already by his thoughts. And of course, at that time, the Club of Rome was a big issue that has been discussed also. Besides that, in microeconomics, in the sense of business, it didn't have much of a impact yet at that point. After having worked in the field of consulting, coming from that very high-level school, we were invited to work in very prestigious consulting projects, such as strategic planning for ABB or Sulzer, which are two major Swiss machinery companies. And it struck me, especially when we worked for a Swiss company that produced tooth wheels that are used in watches, for instance, or micro machines. They have to be extremely precise. They have to be cut on the nanometer. I mean, very, very small. Nano is a. I think it's a million meter small, millions of a meter small. And those were ancient machines that we had in that storage room. I happened to discover them. They had happened to come back from China, and they were being operated kind of in Las Vegas. You have these game machines, the one-arm bandits, where you pull down and then sort of the machine goes on and it tells you if you have one or not. Very similar setup, but it would produce one wheel at the time, and all it would require is manpower. After 50 years, that machine, those machines, there were about 20 of them, had been shipped back from China for revision. And I didn't think of it much. But then when we got into our project for the same company, which produced the very most modern machines producing these tooth wheels by the millions, gazillions basically, because they're very, very tiny, almost like a piece of dust sometimes, so small they were. We had reached a level where we would use the finest materials developed in space, actually, for space travel, that went into that machine. And still, it has been optimized to a degree where after 5 years with this very tough material, still the machine would not be able to produce those kind of precision tooth wheels anymore and had to be thrown away altogether. Now, this is not a small machine. This is a machine as big as a house. I would say a two-story, one-family house. That's about the size of the machine that produced these tooth wheels by the millions without having people employed. And then I asked myself, what is going on? I mean, we are not giving work to people. We are just throwing away such a great machine which has such extremely expensive, high-tech quality materials in order to produce something that we have produced 50 years ago at the same level of precision with a machine that comes from China back to be revised in Switzerland. And the only difference is it's modern. So, what is the kind of development going on? And it came to my mind somehow this professor, Dr. Winswanger, had some good points, and that is that we're just using resources completely irresponsibly. And by the same way, abusing people in the same way. We're not even giving them work anymore. I mean, the industrial progress is not such that it employs more people. It employs always less people. And so destruction of environment comes along with unemployment of people. That's progress. That's what we call progress. And of course, productivity goes up. That is true too. But productivity for what exactly? For doing more destruction? For getting more unemployment? So that was the question at a very young age after university, which went through my mind and made me have this image of industry actually making a race in rowing boats. Every industry would occupy, every company of an industry would occupy a rowing boat in a competition. And they will try to row as fast as possible. And if you have that picture in mind, about 10 rowing boats beside each other, with teams of 10s rowing as fast as they can, they go by the millimeter. They're like almost all the same speed, and they reach the goal. They're going toward the goal very fast. And there is this yeller looking at the direction of how they go. And he gives a tact, and he says, go, 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 well, isn't it? And then they row all together, and they go a little bit faster as the other goes faster. So I had the impression that I, as a consultant, was kind of a yeller. I'm hopping from one boat to the other and teaching them how to go faster. The problem is, not only these boats were actually not going very much faster. Once we taught these companies how to go faster, the other ones were also taught, and the competition would like make everybody go faster. And the benefit of our consulting wasn't really a competitive advantage after all. And the second thing is, we were driving towards Niagara Falls. Nobody cared about it. We're just driving faster and faster down Niagara, Lawrence River, and Niagara Falls was coming up, and we could hear the sound, but that's not part of the game, so let's go faster. And what comes next day, if we fall over the river, falls, nobody cares about, actually. Nobody cares about it. And that struck me so much, that I said, I can't continue in this profession. I have to do something about changing the field of activity of industry. I have to contribute to change that field of activity. Another metaphor that came to my mind was a soccer game. A soccer game is a very civilized game in a way. It's very brutal, but still there's many, many rules and how you have to behave in order to win over the other team. And the soccer players have to stick to these rules or they're thrown out. First they're giving a yellow card and then they would be given a red card if they don't follow the rules, and they are out, and the team has one player less. So everybody tries to behave more or less to the rules of the game because of that sanction that there is. Now imagine you have a soccer game where everybody's allowed to do everything. For instance, you could come and dig a big hole in the middle of the field and cover it with leaves. So your enemy team, I call it on purpose the enemy team, adversary team, would not know that there is a big hole. So you would play the game in a way that all these enemy team players would fall into that trap. Now, that's a good advantage for one game. You would win over the adversary team in that particular game. But how about the field, the soccer field? Would, after that once winning match, the field still serve as a soccer game field for playing games with each other? No, because the enemy would also dig holes. And after all, you would no more have a soccer field to play on. That's basically what's going on with industry. It destroys the very basis it's using. It destroys the market by cutting off people from income, by making them unemployed. At the same time, it destroys the very basis of where it grows from, the earth. It uses up all the material, it destroys the climate, it poisons the water, it destroys the land, it is a complete disaster. Industrial civilization is basically turning the whole planet into a garbage bag. That's basically what it's doing. And so I realized that and I said, I'll have to do something about this development. And I went to Greenpeace, because at that time Greenpeace was to me one of the most progressive organizations fighting complete destruction of the planet. And we had some good successes, I must say, during the time I was there. I wasn't completely involved in these projects, but I was witnessing those successes of the London Dumping Convention. So industry would not be allowed anymore to just dump everything into the oceans. You would have to get rid of the stuff on land. Let's say chemical couldn't be thrown into the ocean anymore, or atomic waste would have to be deposited somewhere on land and not just into the ocean. And they did it very cleverly. I cannot go into the details how they did it, but it was an amazing brain, human effort, extremely clever with very little resources compared to what these other companies had to fight Greenpeace. And they were successful. They had an impact. However, later on I realized that even if we have small successes like a Montreal Protocol, not to produce CFCs and let them in the air and have the ozone cover destroyed, which we absolutely need in order to survive. It protects us from UV radiation. Nothing grows without the ozone layer. if we have the Montreal Protocol, and we cannot destroy the oceans by making them completely radioactive. I realized as long as there is civilized industrial civilization, we will still go down the same path, because there is no way we can stop the development by making other rules to that game, as long as these people playing the game have not understood and continue to actually destroy wherever and whatever can. We are not fast enough to come up with solutions and fight destruction elements. If the ones who destruct are faster and have more resources and multiply even, and go to bigger countries like China and India. For instance, I have spent about 7 years of my life after Greenpeace to build a solar energy and energy saving company. It was a cooperative, it was a non-profit cooperative. We mobilized within these 7 years, and it wasn't in the media at that time. Climate change was not even in the media. Nobody talked about it, but we talked about it in the street with young people. We could mobilize 20,000 donors, young people mostly, who would support us in the effort of saving the climate, of making that ice bear also have in the future have some ice to walk on, saving the planet from calamities which would bring more storms and droughts and devastation of areas by desertification or killing the rainforests by missing water. All that was discussed at the time on the street with young people, and actually we were surprised that so many young people would support us, and then the elderly generation also would support us by giving money, investing their money in our projects, and we were actually able to build quite a few solar energy plants in the heart of Zurich, which then would be feeding into the public net as pure solar produced electricity. We would go to schools and we would change lamps, fan, optimize the energy consumption, and do it in a productive way, meaning that we invest the money and only what in energy costs they save, they would pay us back in order to pay the investments for. So that was a whole huge effort to build that non-profit organization, and actually I got quite a big success. For some reason Krishna's taken me out of all that development. I fell into a deep depression, and during that time I actually realized that it will not change, it will not have an effect. All these green energies, these wonderful solar energies, wind energies, energy saving schemes, it will not change a darn thing at the very end. It will not make a small difference, not even. It will just maybe delay us 5 years, maybe, from the big disaster. That's it. It will not change the basic parameters of our predicament, that the climate change will be so huge that it will actually annihilate most life on Earth.
So what you're saying basically is that since a number of years through industrialization, different countries around the world and scientists have been active in so many different ways, but actually a lot of that is just causing all kinds of destruction, and the whole planet Earth is in a very chaotic and difficult situation now. And because you were involved in many of these things, ultimately your conclusion was that they're not really giving the actual what's actually missing. I guess that's the point. What is your understanding of what is missing in the different attempts that are being made, where huge amounts of monies are being spent?
Yes, also. Yes. So my next step was I came to Krishna consciousness, and I understood that this is all Maya. It's a world created by Krishna temporarily. Prabhupada explains it very nicely. So why do we care for it? Why do we care about it anyway? It's a temporary world. Let's go back to Vaikuntha. Let's go to the spiritual world. At best, Goloka Vrindavan, and let's forget about this material world. Nothing can be done to save it. Nothing. Nothing can be done. We will not be able to save it. That was the state of mind I had when I went to New Vrindavan four years ago.
Your initial impression, or initial thought. Yeah.
Yes, let's just forget about this world. And then I heard about Bhakti Raghava Swami, who was acting on some Varnasram philosophy, and actually still trying to save the world via Krishna consciousness. So that puzzled me completely, because it was a complete contradiction to what I came to conclusion for. And so this Varnasram philosophy struck me, since I always wanted to give a positive change. And I was very surprised, positively surprised, that the Hare Krishna movement is not only about the next world, but also about this world, and how we live in this world, and how we could actually live in harmony with nature in this world. And that's where it actually came in as a new aspect of thinking. But let me still make a little excursion to what you just addressed, to the desperate, I would say the dire situation of planet Earth right now as we speak. The best thing is to read the compiled documents of Professor Dr. Guy McPherson. It's on guymcpherson.org. In the internet, you can find it very easily. He has a summary. The summary is about 3 pages long, and he compiles all the documents that we need to understand how dire the situation is. And it's all scientific, it's all reference journal literature, referee journal literature. Nothing comes out of his own pen. He just compiled the data as a paleoclimatologist, speciation and extinction specialist. He can actually go back many, many million years in the history of Earth and document how species have appeared and disappeared. And he says there is no species who have come for many million years ago and are still here. Species come and go, like people come and go, or like any like any animal or any plant is also the species, something temporary. It appears and it disappears. So there's nothing new about extinction. Extinction isn't something new to our time.
But there is something new.
Something new to our time is that we cause our own extinction. That's actually quite a special phenomenon. And the PETM, please forgive me if I don't correctly pronounce this abbreviation. It was 60 million years ago, and it was called the Pleistocene Eocene temperature maximum, something like that. Please forgive me if it's not correct, but you look it up in the internet. PETM. 60 million years ago, we had an abrupt climate change. Over many thousand years, the climate got warmer, about 25 degrees above our pre-industrial baseline. So the PETM, I think, was more than 20 degrees above pre-industrial baseline of temperature, and it had a parts per million concentration of CO2 of about 400, and it led to over 95% of the species getting extinct. All because some major meteorites had scratched, not even touched the Earth, but scratched the Earth in the Siberian area, and had the methane come out, and that was enough to cause this disastrous development, which then took millions of years for re-speciation, for life coming back. Today, we find ourselves in a situation where we actually lose 200 species a day. I mean, it's an unimaginable thing. It's faster than at the PETM phase. We are faster. We are getting rid of more species a day than at that disaster 60 million years ago, which was the biggest disaster ever on Earth.
And that's connected with, you were mentioning a few days ago about methane in different ways, increasing at a very dangerous level. Cows, for example, and then something about the Earth warming up,
yes,
producing methane. Can you explain that briefly?
Yes. The cause that got this all rolling was the burning of oil, coal, oil and gas, the fossil fuels. It put an enormous amount of CO2 into the earth. CO2 is the waste product of burning fossil fuels. And as I said, we doubled the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. It is now at 400 parts per million instead of 200 parts per million, where or below where it should be. And that is the same level as at the PETM. So the effect of having this high CO2 is already enough to kill us all. It's already enough. We will have the same effect as the PETM had on global climate change. But the problem is even worse, and that's where the methane comes in. Since we are warming the planet quickly, and in the poles, especially the North Pole, the warming is taking place even faster. We have been observing in our global temperature an increase by last October 15 of 1.5 degrees since industrial civilization has started. And since then, in only 6 months, we have been observing an increase of global temperature by 0.6 degrees. So in half a year, we have almost done 50% of what has taken 150 years. And that's exponential. So why do we suddenly have this exponential increase on temperature? It's because there are so-called self-reinforcing feedback loops. One of them is, for instance, we have a melting of the ice in the Arctic. The ice in the Arctic has been covering the North Pole for all the time that humans have been on Earth. There have never been humans on Earth when the North Pole was free of ice. Now, this ice has gone mostly away, and 2016 is probably the year where we will have the first Arctic Blue Ocean event. That means there is no ice, or less than a few million square meters, which is considered no ice, beyond this huge amount of surface. And where the self-reinforcing feedback loops comes in is, ice has an albedo effect. That means the sun is shining onto the snow, onto the white surface, and reflecting the radiation back into space. But now there is open water, and the radiation goes right into the water and heats it up. So as the water gets warmer, more ice melts. And as more ice melts, more radiation gets absorbed in the ocean. And that again makes melt more ice more quickly. So that is a so-called self-reinforcing feedback loop. And it cannot be stopped. It is unstoppable. A very similar effect is the methane. Methane is a common molecule, and it has been trapped with hydrogen in a hydrogen cloth, in a hydrogen cage. And in cold temperature, it sinks down onto the ocean bottom. It is also stored in the permafrost in northern Siberia, northern Canada, northern Alaska. As these areas melt, permafrost is melting, all the methane comes up because the clathrate cannot longer be stable, and it releases the methane atom into the atmosphere. The same is with the methane at the bottom of the ocean. As the ocean gets warmer, these methane clathrates are broken up, and the methane comes out. And we have to imagine huge areas as big as 100 kilometers across, which is bubbling like a glass of ginger ale or Coke.
So this is creating tremendous, unprecedented imbalances.
It's incredible.
Mind-boggling, yes.
I heard, and I'm not sure though, it can be looked up with Guy McPherson's webpage or in any other climatologist page. I've heard that the effect of the methane is today as big as the effect of the CO2.
So, in so many words, what you have explained is that our planet is in bad shape.
Yes, actually, Professor Dr. Guy McPherson comes to the conclusion, as an extinction and speciation specialist, that there is no way we're going to survive this as a species, because we depend on too many species, and they are all going extinct, 200 a day. So how the human race, as the only one species, would survive as a mammal, is to him, would take a miracle.
So such kind of professional people, scientists, are coming to that conclusion. What is our Vedic perspective?
Well, that's where we devotees kind of get puzzled. I mean, they're talking about short term. They're not talking 2100. They're talking 2025, where there's no more humans on the planet. They're talking 2030, where guaranteed there is no more humans on the planet. And not because it's too warm or too cold for humans. They just put on the AC or put on more clothes or heat with some gas. We can adapt to that. But there is no more food. And we can observe already that it is raining too much or too little. Last summer in 15 in Switzerland, we had no rain all the summer. It rained last in June. It didn't rain until the end of November. Never happened before. Never observed such a summer before. And this summer it rained all the time. Both had the effect that there is not enough crop.
So where does the Om Sri Surabhi campaign come in?
Right. So, so in this desperate situation where we're actually looking into our all common demise, hopelessness, complete hopelessness, we depend on a miracle, and I'm almost sure that since this world has been created by Krishna, that Om Sri Surabhi campaign is going to take us out of this mess. I don't think we can fix it.
Right.
Humans are thinking about artificial trees, are putting all these chemicals into the atmosphere to keep solar radiation management, to cool the planet. All that stuff is not going to work. We have messed it up. All that stuff will mess it up even more. But if we go back to Krishna's design, to Krishna's plans, to Varnashram, the plans, the old Vedic literature, how humans should live with cows on their land, produce their own food, I think then we can turn around that whole thing. And here, Dr. Alan Savory, he's famous from his TED TED show. Please look it up in TED. Alan Savory, he says the only hope. The only hope human can has is to have masses of cows grazing on these desertified grasslands globally, refertilizing it, making the grass grow again in these grasslands, And these grasses, astonishingly, they grow roots 8 meters deep. So that would be the only and perfect storage of CO2. It would take the methane and the CO2 out of the atmosphere and put it into the ground.
Where it belongs.
Where it belongs. in the form of these roots for hundreds of years.
Yes.
It would be the possible solution using cows, using cow dung, using cow urine, using the hoofs of the cows, which are trampling the grass.
That means to a large extent we should get out, or need to get out of this madness of the industrial race that is ongoing.
Yes, I think Krishna is going to take out of this industrial civilization anyway. Peak oil is one topic. We have probably reached peak oil in 2005 and are living on some flary bust of shale gas, which is not very sustainable and not very long. We will run out of petrol quite soon, actually. It will cause a collapse in the financial system, in the industrial civilization system. We will depend again on growing our own food, on having our own cows, on being able to heat our own room with something that grows close by, like a forest. Mm-hmm. And if we don't change that way of life, we will die from freezing or from not having food anyway. But if we go that way, we reverse actually, and we can actually, using cows and agriculture on a very large scale, however, it has to be done on a climate emergency Marshall plan requiring US defense budget amounts, on a global effort, that we have actually the possibility of multiplying these cows by the millions and gazillions, so that they replace the former buffaloes in the northern plains in the US, mimic those buffaloes, trample the grass that's still there, urinate and dung on it, make this way a kind of a mulch under which this fresh new grass can grow, and grow these roots. And as soon as these roots are grown over 3, 4, 5 years, it's enough. All that CO2 and methane goes into the earth.
So it means that this whole endeavor is not meant simply or only to be an undertaking of ISKCON as a society, but it should be taken up by governments all over the world.
As Dr. Alan Savage says, it's the only hope for humankind. So if any government in the world cares at all about its population surviving, and it usually does, why would it have an army? Why would it have storage for desperate times? Why would it have educational system? Why would it have systems for health maintaining the population? If any government in the world is actually looking into the future with clarity and not doing the normal cognitive dissonance reaction that ordinary people do by saying, this is too much, we cannot deal with it, let's keep the race on towards Niagara Falls. Let's not think about Niagara Falls today. Maybe tomorrow, but not today. But if you have a sanely minded government around the world, they would pick up Varnasrama-Dharma. They would actually join in ISKCON in this tremendous effort and save habitat for humans.
Yes.
It's the only hope.
We are otherwise, as Srila Prabhupada mentions, following suicidal policies.
It's absolutely 100% true. I don't know how Srila Prabhupada was able to look into the future like that, but even 2011, the first scientist realized the dire development of the methane coming up. How Prabhupada was able to see that 40 years earlier escapes my mind. But he saw it. It's all suicidal policies. This way of so-called progress of industrial civilization, it's a heat engine. Any industrial civilization is a heat engine. Whatever we do, if we use alternative energies, if we save energy, if we recycle, if we whatever we do, it doesn't help at all. After all, if we don't go back to this very simple lifestyle with cows, with land, with Krishna.
Yes.
And that's not enough. If we have the absolute clear strategy of regrowing these grasslands, these desertified grasslands, which is 2/3 of the world's surface. Mm. If we manage to do that, we have a chance as a human species. And that's probably where the Kali Yuga comes in. And it should go on for another, what is it, Maharaj, 330,000 years or something? And it seems to be going on somehow. And Dr. Guy McPherson, he must be wrong according to Vedic literature.
Mm.
So, I think he has not considered the Krishna factor. And we maybe should go into that direction of helping Alan Savary, working together with these kind of initiatives of actually networking and making governments move into that direction, because otherwise, what is the purpose? There is anything you do, it has no purpose 10 years from now, 15 years from now, because we're all gone. We'll all be gone. I'm laughing about the Swiss constructing a very fast train going from north to south, traversing the country, spending billions of Swiss francs. We will not use it. We will not be here. We will not even see the end of its construction.
Yes.
And at the same time, we don't even think about regrowing these grasslands, which would save us and create the future. And we observe the dramatic climate changes. We document the dramatic climate changes. There is no doubt about it. There are some stupid climate change denier sponsored by fossil fuel companies. But even the fossil fuel companies themselves say that climate is probably going to change 6 degrees by 2100. 6 degrees is death for everybody. There's no more humans on Earth with 6 degrees. Change.
So even they are acknowledging.
They are making plans for 6 degrees raise in temperature, whereas last July they had a meeting in Paris that where they declared, global governments declared they would do everything that 2 degrees would not be reached or more, would not be trespassed. What is the word exactly? It would be the absolute limit, 2 degrees. But we have reached 2 degrees already, basically. It's as Guy McPherson says, it's baked in the cake. There is no, unless we actually drop industrial civilization, if we walk away from it, we actually have to walk away from it. We go to Varnasram and we have these huge herds, cows who refertilize and regrow the grasslands. So, we are all done.
So would you agree that if we don't walk away from it, it will walk away from us?
Yes, it is walking away at very high speed.
It is running away.
I mean, think about it. Last summer, due to these change in weather patterns, and it comes from the fact that the North Pole is now much warmer. So the temperature gradient between the North Pole and the rest of the globe is less. And if that difference in temperature is less, it's like a river that doesn't come down from the mountain straight, but it comes down into the flat plain. And what it does when it comes in a flat plain, it kind of meanders, right? These rivers, they go left, they go right. And that's what happens now to the Chet Stream. The Chet Stream is that stream that should actually isolate the North Pole from the rest of the globe, keep the cold air up there, and just check around it. And it would transport weather to Europe, to North America, to Russia, by going around quickly, and we would have maybe 2 days of rain and then 3 days of sunshine. And then again, maybe a week of rain and then 3 weeks of sunshine. But it doesn't happen this way anymore. This jet stream is now meandering. It's meandering. It gets stuck. So it gets stuck in a certain way that we have 5 months, 6 months of no rain, or 5 and 6 months of total rain.
So everything becomes deregulated.
Totally deregulated, and we cannot grow food.
Yes.
Under such conditions. Yes. That is the disaster. That is the disaster.
So to summarize, what advice would you have to those who are listening in a nutshell, what is our way out of dilemma?
One Swami was with his disciple in Vrindavan, and they were sleeping outdoors, and the Swami got kind of excited, and he said, there's a tiger, in the area. The villagers have told me there's a tiger. We should be careful. So the Swami picks up a little stick, not bigger than that, and he puts it beside him. And the student asks, Swamiji, this little stick, is it actually going to help you to defend yourself against a tiger? And then Swamiji says, well, you know, I can do a little bit, the rest Krishna has to do. So, I mean, for a Swami, a Rishi, it is probably impossible to defend itself against a beast like a tiger if it attacks. Whatever stick you have, even if you have a sword, probably. even with the gun, you might be too late if you're sleeping. So, he depends on Krishna. He says, okay, I do this what I can, the Krishna has to do the rest. We need a miracle. From a scientific point of view, only a miracle can save us. But let's put it this way. Krishna has created this earth. He is in charge of everything. Now, the miracle can come. Anyway, it's a miracle we live. It's a total miracle. There is life. The odds of us being here is, according to Guy McPherson, he has done the math, is less than plucking any atom in the whole universe. And us having a human body is like having won the lottery every day in our life. I mean, what are the odds to win the lottery once in our life? But what are the odds of winning the lottery every day in our life? I mean, this is such an incredible miracle already that we exist.
So what you're saying is that we have reached such a level and point that unless, practically speaking, there is Krishna's intervention, but at the same time, we should be making the endeavor.
Right. So if we don't do, if we don't at least pick up that little stick, if we don't have these cows protected,
correct.
If we don't have a huge amount, like Alan Savory, huge herds deployed on the grasslands, if we don't give Krishna a chance to intervene, he might not intervene. I mean, how can he? I mean, he could, but you know, at least we should show some desire.
The Lord helps those who help themselves.
Yes.
As George Harrison would tell us.
And in some Alan Savory documentary, somewhere it is said that if in Australia, those grasslands, which has been turned into growing wheat for on an industrial agricultural basis, and which has then created desertification, and there are huge areas like that in Australia, huge, huge areas, tremendous areas. Australia is a big continent.
Other countries also.
Sorry?
And other countries also.
Yes, but let's only talk about this for the moment, this Australian thing. North America, huge areas have been desertified as well, especially the parks, the natural parks, without the animals. If half of what has been desertified in Australia is reclaimed as grasslands, with the Alan Savory method, protecting the cows, having huge herds of cows. You cannot kill the cows if you want to have huge herds. You need every calf to help. If you do that, half of the grasslands lost in Australia, and these grasses grow 100 years old, tremendous long roots into the desert floor where the water is. If we achieve that goal only, we have pre-industrial levels of CO2. So Australia could do the job for the whole world, if you say. But,
Just Australia itself, you're saying.
Just Australia. But of course, there is no use if all the other countries keep putting more CO2 into the earth, into the atmosphere. It will continue to also kill the oceans. I mean, the oceans have warmed tremendously, have absorbed the heat from the atmosphere. The atmosphere is just a tiny little layer on the globe. The oceans is big masses of water. They have absorbed so much heat, actually the equivalent of one atomic bomb a day, a second. One atomic bomb a second. That's the amount of heat they have absorbed in the last, since industrialization began. But it has now led to the fact that most species in the oceans are dying. The Great Barrier Reef has been bleached last month. We're speaking May 2016, 97% of the Great Barrier Reef, the largest existing living entity on Earth, has died in a month. It has existed for millions of years. In 1 month, it has died. It is the baby station for many, many fish that populate the oceans. It is no more there for them. Sardines have been reduced by 95%. Sardines are the basis of the food chain for the fish. Plankton has been reduced 50%. It's the food for the sardines. The oceans are really in a dire situation. And
so basically you're saying in so many words and by giving all these wonderful examples.
Well, they're not so wonderful, I'm sorry.
Well, they're wonderful in the sense that they are clearly indicating that modern man has totally, we could say, totally disrespecting the natural laws of nature.
Absolutely.
So when we go against the laws of nature, which are created by Krishna, then we can expect such kind of devastation. So the solution, although Alan Savory has touched on it, he touched on a core principle, which is there in the Vedic culture, Vedic lifestyle, of what Prabhupada summarized as more simple living and high thinking, isn't it?
Yeah.
So the solution is...
Yes. And it comes all together for me, this whole experience of going into industry, of being an economical student, of realizing this is not going anywhere, of going into Hare Krishna, yes, going into Greenpeace and alternative energies, and it all boils down to this one thing that you just said, that without respecting the laws of nature, without us living within the biological boundaries,
yes,
that have been given, if we build civilization, if we start storing food for more than what we need, we are already done.
Yes.
So we have to actually live like dolphins or like humans have lived before civilization, maybe migrating with cows or at least close to the Vedic principles of how lifestyle in a harmonic way with nature can be accomplished, where we actually mimic nature in so many ways, living with the cows, as Alan Savory has observed all these things.
Yes.
We are actually mimicking nature. With Krishna was having 900,000 cows.
Yes.
Ananda Maharaj, and Krishna was herding them, calling them every night.
Yes.
Huge herds of cows mimicked or did the same job, let's say, as the buffalo herds did in North America.
Of course, Alan Savory is speaking about mimicking nature, And we are speaking about Vedic culture is advocating actually living with nature.
Living with nature according to what has been described
naturally
in the Shastras.
So real civilization, we can understand, existed before modern day civilization.
Modern day civilization is a very recent invention.
Right, very recent.
It's maybe 150 years old. It has led to, it's a blink of an eye of human existence.
Yes.
Humans are from, humans are said to be 200 million years on Earth. By scientists, if it's true or not, I don't know.
Yes.
150 years in the eye of 200 million years, it's nothing. And we have managed to destruct everything in that short period of time. So this, all the time before, we lived in harmony somehow.
Yes.
Let's go back and let's try to do it under Krishna's guidance. Let's serve the cows. They are our saviors. And as we say in the Om Shri Surabhi campaign, prayer to Shri Surabhi, without you we have no food. Without you we have no mother. Without you, we are not protected. Please allow us to serve you. Please allow us to be with you. Please allow us to have you as our mother. And it comes down to this very Varnasram principle at the end that we have to again discover. And it sounds very strange in the beginning. It was very estranging to me. This whole thing, Gopucha, honoring cows in that way. But looking more deeply into the contexts, Varnashram, Daiva Varnashram and cow protection is the only way out, it's the only hope. And it's not just a religious issue, it's basically the question of to be or not to be.
Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.